I would like to call my guests here who are there, who know the subject very well. And first among them, I would give this off to Khazanchi ji, because Khazanchi sir will tell about situation of hydropower, capacity development, stage of Pune Sancho 1, 2, and also Mangdechu and other projects, because we don't have Mishra ji here. So all of that, I leave it to Khazanchi sir to highlight here. And also probably, Khazanchi sir, you can also put forward ki how much work has been given, you know, to the private operators and opportunities there. Opportunities, I mean to say, we don't have to name the parties, but opportunities that is there. So please come over, Khazanchi sir. Please give a big hand.
Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. All of us should be highly thankful to Professor Iyer for having organized this meet, which you can read here, Hydrovision Conclave 2014, an Indo-Bhutan discussion forum. He has opened the discussion in the right note and in the right direction. When it comes to me, a person who has been in hydropower business for last 5 decades, in fact 51 years I have completed, it becomes something like a person who didn't know counting, and he wanted to pay 11 neutrons to somebody and 11 neutrons to somebody else, two of them. He didn't know what would make the total of 11 and 11. This man goes to a baker and asks that baker, what is 11 plus 11? I want to pay these two people. You know the reply? 22 cakes. This fellow asks for what is 11 plus 11. The baker's reply is, 11 plus 11 is 22 cakes. That is exactly my temperament and my approach in life. I started with something, I'm going to end with that. Baker calling 11 plus 11 is 22 cakes. So whenever you talk to me, I will talk of megawatts, so many billion units, this cost, this time overrun, this problem, that problem, which in fact should not interest you much. But I cannot, as I told you, be telling you anything other than that. So you will have to have a little patience. I last night tried to jot down the situation as on 26th of August. We have the population clock continuously. It has changed even since yesterday. 7.12 billion population on 26th of August 2014. And 1/6 of that are in my country. Something like 1.24 billion. Now, why I'm telling you this? I am a proud Indian. I belong to a country, as Professor Iyer was just now telling you, like that nice, huge, big elephant, without wanting to harm anybody, letting everybody live as best as they can, and living his life also merrily. But one thing most important now for this elephant is also to be providing everything for himself and people around him also getting benefited. We have the friendship between the two countries now spanning over decades and decades through the visionary leaders we had from both the countries, great monarchs of this country. I have great, great regard for at least the two whom I have seen physically, whom I have observed working for this country tirelessly with big vision. Friends, India today, when I compare with the rest of the world, I will talk to you about my cakes. This hydropower is a part of the total electricity generation installation all over the world. So it becomes a fraction of that. So when we see electricity, you can have, it's like a barometer for the well-being and the quality of life of a country. If you see the top 7, 8, 10 countries in the world with highest installed capacity, that means the highest generation per annum, can you believe in 2009, China, with the largest world population of about 1.3 billion souls, used to be at number 3 place, behind US. And today, when we see 2013 figures are, China is at number 1. With an installed capacity touching something like 1,500,000 megawatts. You can compare your own country, where we have less than 1,500, 1,486 to be precise, megawatts. Here, compared to now China's something like 1,500,000. But I will tell you, friends, Bhutan, electricity-wise, is far, far ahead of China. Because then you have to go by per capita installed capacity and per capita what is the total energy available with you annually. As I said, number one, about 1,500,000 of China, is followed by USA, around 900,000. Now question will be, when we compare US with China, China, as I said, has a population of 135 crores, 1.35 billion, as against US's only 31 crores. If you see the per capita installed capacity in the two countries, it's 3 in case of USA, 3 megawatts per thousand, will go per thousand. Otherwise, this will be difficult to explain. 3 megawatts of power catering to 1,000 people. And in China, even being the highest now, it comes to 1.1 megawatt, just 1.1 megawatt per 1,000 population. Highest, friends, is Canada. Canada has an installed capacity of slightly more than 160,000 megawatts. And the population is less, and per capita comes 4.6 megawatts, as against US's 3, they are 1.5 times, 4.6. You can see very quietly the comparison between the two countries. I have first-hand information. I have first-hand experience. I have two sons. The eldest son is in USA. The younger son is in Canada. Canada, absolutely peaceful, less violence in the society, doing exceedingly well. Come to US, this side of the border, lot of unrest. And believe me, now it becomes a straight comparison. 4.5 megawatts for Canada per 1,000, and here only 3. So it works like a barometer. I do not know how it works. This energy availability is straight. Who is what, how well placed. In your case, can you believe, friends, with a population of just 750,000, you have already today running 1,480 megawatts, which works to something like 2 megawatts per 1,000. 2 megawatts, believe me here, 2,000. And you go to my country, in India, our installed capacity, as Professor Iyer was telling you just now, 250,000. And population, 124 crores, 1.24 billion. Do you know what it works? 0.2 megawatts per thousand, and yours is 10 times. And that is how I find Bhutan absolutely peaceful. We have pockets in Bhutan where poverty is noticeable, but generally see the people and compare with India. I'll tell you, friends, in India, as I said, this 124 crore population, we have just three groups. First 40 odd crores, the middle 40 odd crores, and lower 40 odd crores. Our top 40 crores population, which is much more than total US population of 31 crores, are amongst the richest in the world. Two of the first 10 rich people are two brothers, Ambani brothers. 40 odd crore population of my country living in that richest band. Then comes the central 40 crores. That is some people like me and you. Then in the same country, that bottom 40, living below poverty line. See the difference. They may not have a shelter in the evening. They may not have assured two-time meals. That's the time of situation in our country. And that's not so here in Bhutan. Your one-third population is not amongst the richest, if you compare anywhere in the world. Central one-third, yes. Bottom one-third is not comparable to what I said, one-third in my country. They are much, much above that. You may have maybe few percent, 5%, 7%, like that. What I want to tell you is now, same barometer, 0.2 megawatts per thousand in my country and 2 megawatts here. I will talk to you about your future. As Professor Iyer was telling you, we are not only talking of hydrovision now. Discussion is, with hydro, what else can come up? How fast and how well? Nobody can stop the political leadership here, the business leadership here, and people who are enterprising here to have diversity, go into other disciplines, go to other areas, and develop yourself. Nobody is there to stop you. But I would tell you again that baker's cake. What I see in this country, where you have more than 30,000 megawatts of power available, hydropower available, free white gold, liquid gold flowing waste. And out of this, identified by your own country, almost 24,000 megawatts which can be exploited, harnessed very economically. And an excellent decision taken in 2008 between the two countries, my country and your country, that 10,000 megawatts to be added by 2020. Friends, adding 10,000 megawatts of power, you should see. When we were doing Tala, between 1998 and 2006, the total power generation from here was something like 460 megawatts. With 460 megawatts, friends, the consumption that time in your country when I came here was ranging between about 100 odd megawatts, then it would peak to 200 at best. That means on an average, you have all the time surplus power to sell to India. And naturally, an addition to your economy, a revenue to the government. Came 2006, 2007 monsoon season saw Tala generating 1020 continuously. And then continuously thereafter. This 460 odd with Tala's 1820 became 1486. With 1486, go back in time, all of you, right from 2007 onwards, see the change in Thimphu's tea. And that is a barometer again. And I will tell you, that is that baker's cake. That was available and it came up. Take all other sectors, tourism, agriculture, anything, horticulture, animal husbandry, your forest, this. All those, when you compare with this sudden change of just one adding one station, they cannot compare, they cannot just compare. And if 1,000 could give that change, imagine 10,000 megawatts coming by, if not 2020, because hydropower has a lot of unforeseen things, a lot of factors which can delay completion beyond what schedules we generally frame. Construction schedules, again, we frame too optimistic. We get educated from our previous experience, previous working, but we don't carry it forward because we do not want to have a group doing hydropower and where you allow them a long rope in time and cost. So intentionally, the decision makers keep the cost at the time of sanction low, give a very, very tight schedule for completion. Friends, when you think of hydropower in this country, you have to think of the availability of manpower. You have to find, most important, to find finances for it. And then the equipment. And then the trained set of people, trained teams and crew, who will be able to run it efficiently after it gets commissioned. See, today, the arrangement between the two governments is, you have India coming in here, providing you finances, and with people like me and Mr. Amit Gupta coming from India, only in key positions, senior positions, mostly new, fresh recruits, fresh graduates from engineering colleges of this country, engineering colleges elsewhere outside this country, but Bhutanese nationals, join and work with us. During the construction of the project, they get on the job training and experience. And by the time a project is complete, the locals here working 5 to 6 to 8 years continuously with these outsiders are in a capacity to take over the operation and maintenance of the projects in full. Very few people here may perhaps know, when we were doing Tala, we had at the close of the day something like, if I remember correctly, 806 people. 806 people running that project. Out of 806 people, which were left for running and maintenance that time, were still in that handing over, taking over mode. Can you tell me the number of Bhutanese that time that would have been running that show? Out of 806, make any rough guess, any wild guess, how many should have been the nationals that time out of 806 when we handed over? May anybody, please? 806 in Tala were available at the time of handing over. How many should have been the Bhutanese nationals? Bhutanese. And today, if you go to Tala, Chukha, Kurchu, Basachu, 100% Bhutanese, full generation, 10% overload, year after year, whatever water is available, they use, they utilize. That is the strength of Bhutan. Again, now that elephant, you got to trust that elephant. Trust the elephant and you will see it. You will, believe me, prosper. You will go, you have to think of, you will go in that top 33% bracket of Indians. And most of you, it will be 66% of this country going to that top 33 of ours, will be comparable. Friends, something very, very important which I want to tell especially the youth here. You may have observed last year, even year before last, lot of cry about the cost and time overrun of hydroelectric projects, especially the ones which you are doing now. We have, friends, under this 10,000 megawatts initiative taken between the two governments, we started Puna Sangchu 1. It has a capacity of 1,200 megawatts, about 20% more than Tala. And that was the first in 10,000 megawatts, came second and third, 1,020 megawatts of Puna Sangchu 2 in this same river basin, downstream of 1. And in the next basin, we have Mangdechu, 720 megawatts. Now, friends, after doing Tala, after seeing Tala constructed in a comparatively very good time frame of almost 8 years of active construction, 1998 to 2006, people in Bhutan have the who are associated with it, have that general impression that hydropower, like 1,000, 1,200, is something like a child's play. Believe me, friends, all of us who are in this business, I have my colleague, Mr. Walkley here on the left, I have my colleagues in the government working, they will tell you how difficult it becomes to really do a hydroelectric project. Friends, you will get an idea. My own country, where we have 250,000 megawatts installed capacity, against 1486 here. Can you believe what would be the number of 1,000 and above stations in India out of this 250,000? It's just five. Five in government, one in private sector. I have the list with me. Napta Jagri, it's in Himachal Pradesh, 1,500 megawatts. It was done the time we were doing Tala. Bakra, done long back, late 50s, early 60s. And can you believe the first station on that? It was done in two phases. First station was less than 1,000. Then years later came the second station. And two together is 1,325 megawatts. Third, Sardar Sarovar in the state of Gujarat in my country, 1,200 megawatts. Tehri Dam in Uttarakhand, about which all of us, you may be aware, it had a lot of environmental issues associated with it, lot of debate on seismicity of Himalayas and the stability of a dam which is more than 250 meters height, 1,000 megawatts. Tehri, we had been hearing for more than 2.5 decades, 1,000 megawatts. Then came Madhya Pradesh's Indira Sagar, 1,000 megawatts. This is all. Koina in Maharashtra, we did it over a long period, and it has four stages. One of the stages is about 1,000, but less. We have a huge big station in the state of Andhra Pradesh, Srisailam. In Srisailam, two stages, both below 1,000 each. In private sector, one of the construction companies working with us, Jaiprakash Associates Limited, did 1,000 megawatts in Himachal Pradesh, which got commissioned somewhere in 2009 and 2010. This is the whole set. And compare against 240,000, 250,000, these six stations I have named. And here in 1486, you have one of 1,000. So when this 1,020 came, everybody thinks that hydropower is Very simple. Today, the organization from which I come, NHPC. NHPC has less than 3,000 megawatts installed capacity today. Can you believe, friends, not a single 1,000 megawatt station? The highest capacity station we have in NHPC, that is the largest hydropower utility we have in India, highest is 690 megawatts Salal hydroelectric project in J&K, which is lesser in capacity compared even to the third project here in 10,000 megawatts, Mangdechu, which is 720. So friends, especially for the youth here, I would like you to get conscious that what is being done by the government here in association with us in India, in Indian government, is something very big. It's not very small. Doing 1,720 stations like that is not small. Today, you are a very happy community, a very happy nation with in hand about 3,000 megawatts of hydropower under construction. One of them getting commissioned very soon, Dagachu. You are lucky that four more projects in joint venture with Indian public sector, with the DGPC here, coming up with, again, something like more than 2,000 megawatts. And then it will be followed by Kuri Gungri in the east. It will be followed in the Punasangchu Basin by Sankosh. And imagine now, against 1486, you will have something like additional 10,000 megawatts, God willing, latest by 2023. Latest, full 10,000. Imagine what would be the situation here. And you would have certainly gotten that 66% mode of where we are in India at 33 top. Day before yesterday, our Honorable Secretary, Minister of Economic Affairs, who was on his way to Dagachu, which is getting commissioned very soon, he had a stopover at our two projects. And we're talking about the first highway tunnel in the country, which was not done for transportation to reduce distance between two ends. No, it was a necessity for us for construction of Punasangchu 2 dam. It's a 1.5 kilometer tunnel. I do not know how many of you may have traversed through that tunnel. It's done properly, since it happened to be the first highway tunnel in the country. When he visited us yesterday, he was then thinking of that this should be for our entire highway network. I said, God willing, after 2025, you will have it wherever it's possible. Thimphu Paro getting connected, Thimphu Wangdi getting connected, and elsewhere in the country. That is the future of development in this country, and main will be that bakery shop of hydropower. Friends, I come down to now exactly going to my small little oven. Bakeries are too many. We have 10,000 megawatts to do. I come down to this 2220, which we are doing in Punasangchu 1 and 2. Friends, till June end, we had spent something like 62,000 neutrums, which came as Indian rupee, and wherever we had the requirement of the hard currency, it came in dollars. 62,000 came here, and we have spent in full. Now, I want to give you a figure. How much has accrued to the government here through taxes which we pay, especially the income tax and the company tax who work here, plus then the local businessmen who work with us. All infrastructure, we put 100% to local businessmen. Out of this 62,000, our audited figures are accrual in Bhutan 20,000 million out of 62. and retained in Bhutan. Again now, Bhutanese entrepreneurs, business houses working with us have to get resources to do their part of the project from India. That means that much outflow from whatever budget we have. When I talk of net, what stays in this country was 9,000 million. 9,000 million. Out of 62,000, 9,000 has net stayed in this country. And in last 4.5 years, it gives you something like 200 crores a year. Indian currency coming to this country, net 200 crores per year for the last 4.5 years. Now, I come to the subject which Professor Iyer also touched, crunch, Indian rupee crunch in this country. How I would like to understand. I read a number of articles by some very good economists from this country and also from my country, everybody blaming hydropower, the greatest villains on earth. I have not understood how this hydropower development here in this country, especially the under construction ones, would be a drain on Indian rupee reserve with this country. I have failed to understand, believe me. I may not perhaps understand economics. Friends, coming down now small in that oven, what I find, today the employment provided, directly people working under our own administrative control for the two projects and with our contractors. Can you think of the appointments given? It's something like 3,000 people. 3,000 families are provided with their living. We come to the, I don't know, you may be knowing, we have small township in Wangdi, the old town near that Zong area got shifted. Well before 2007-2008, when we were carrying out the pre-construction stage investigations of Punasam 2-1, we saw on the other bank of the river, when you travel from Thimphu, we are on the right bank of the river as the river flows. On the left bank, we had a huge big area of land, roads laid out, plots already done, and electric poles, the street lighting provided, without electricity, but. And nobody came for construction in 2008, nobody came for construction in 2009. It was only, yes, towards the end of 2009, that initially there had been some local problems about the allotments and who would get it and who would not get it. Finally, the construction took off. Friends, without any agreement, without any memorandum of understanding with us, people came up with construction, yes, because they were shifted from the old town. Everybody there owning 4-story houses, 3+ attic. Without any understanding, without any commitment from the two authorities for their houses to be taken on rent. Yes, it was an opportunity for us. We could see it. We saved money. We did not do temporary construction for people who have to be there at the construction stage. Because at the construction stage, we have today directly under our administrative control about 2,000 people, which ultimately when you go to the operation maintenance stage, we have worked out details. It works to something like 1,008. So for 1,008, we are trying to do permanent colonies at various locations in the project area, which is essential for the operation and maintenance stage. But that additional 1,000, which is required for construction, believe me, we are 100% on rent. We have rented all those buildings. And when they see the main colony coming up, we have gone slow on the construction of the main colony, which is ultimately required for the O&M stage. Towards the end of the project construction, we have to shift. People have started feeling now uneasy. that why these people will ship from here. That's the type of the advantage of a project like this. I have my figures. We have taken something like 26,000 square meters of constructed area. 26,000 square meters. Number of buildings, both sides. On the right bank of the river in Mangdi, we have Lobesa. On the other bank is this Majutan. And do you know what we pay? Per month, we pay something like almost 3 million dirhams. Again, that is Indian currency getting into the local economy. Friends, for the local community and our own people now who are living there, we did two schools, existing schools, extensions. It could be as good as new schools. 18 classrooms and an administrative building. To provide, yes, education for people who are working directly with us and for the local communities. We have, friends, health facilities created. I don't know how many of you would be knowing. We had a small basic health unit, BHU, in Wangdi on the other bank, this Baju end, a small one. The time we took over and started Punosam 2-1, immediately it was upgraded. We added units and expanded. It was more than doubled. Today we have facility for plus 20 beds and we have converted into a district hospital. All these things do not come to the notice of the public unless we have a forum like this where we could be speaking about it. I'm so happy to be a part. I'll, friends, like to tell you here, you'll find very few people from the government here. I think I may be the only exception. But I'm really very, very happy to be here, to be talking to you, to be telling you what I feel from my heart. I'm not speaking from my head, believe me. We have, friends, health facilities to be provided for the entire catchment of that area, starting right from Punaka, a 40-bedded hospital. A beautiful structure will come up. God willing, next 3 years it will be operational, including a residential complex for the doctors and the paramedical and the administrative staff of that 40-bedded hospital. It will be the most modern hospital of that size in this country. And the cost, something like 550 million, 55 crores, which we are doing through both the projects as centralized. But these are very small things. If you go there, you'll find the cooperative farming. They have from various districts, right from the Punaka, you go down, right to the border, people sending their produce, farm produce, to weekly markets here and see what has been the purchase, what has been the business through our project, through two projects. It's amazing if you see the change there. And believe me, all my colleagues, we are really excited to be a part of it. Yes, our problems and challenges are also there, very big. We're doing Punasam 2-1 hydroelectric project. Friends, I do not know how much time Professor Iyer will give me.
No, you can go on, sir, no problem.
No, time also you have to tell me.
Another 10 minutes.
10 minutes, okay. Friends, when we do a detailed project report, now I will come to the technicalities. When we do detailed project report of such size magnitude, projects, we have best of the organizations available in India for a job like this. Both these projects were investigated and the DPR was framed by WAPCOS, which is a Government of India undertaking. It is a Schedule B company of Government of India, and one of my colleagues here, Mr. Amit Gupta, he has just left the seat, works for that organization as our senior project manager at site. This company associates best of the Indian organizations, full government departments, like Central Water Commission is in the Ministry of Water Resources in India, Central Electricity Authority is in Ministry of Power. We involve Geological Survey of India. That's the oldest British time organizations of geology in India. Then we have Survey of India for precise surveying and aligning things, especially underground tunnels which keep on going in zigzags and yet without any problems. All these organizations come to do a DPR, investigation, and then finally a detailed project report. The limitations, friends, that time are, I would like to highlight here in the next 5 minutes, limitation of having an appropriate group of people at site with proper expertise. Because, you know, with expertise comes with experience. And according to me, best experience a person can have comes after about 2.5 decades of working very intimately with a particular profession. So anybody who is in early 50s, late 40s, is the right person who should be available in the field to have various alternatives assessed correctly and zeroed in on an alternative which is to be taken up for construction. What happens generally in our culture, that's the Eastern culture, the DPR formulation, the investigation, is not taken as seriously as when we go for construction. Because, as you will agree, doing a DPR, doing an investigation, is peanuts as compared to the cost of such mega projects. So the seriousness of getting people and placing them there, providing facilities for them, I recall days when we used to get senior people. Generally, you'll find people after 45, after 50, having high blood pressure, hypertension, generally. And when it comes for them to come to high altitudes, and that too, high altitudes where you don't have proper roads, you don't have even proper tracks, and where they will have to trek to go to locations which ultimately matter for deciding the final component-wise location, it becomes extremely difficult for them. And even if we get such people, real good experts, we have top people, they come for a day or two. And getting the best, optimizing the best of a project doesn't come with such visits only 2 to 3 times. This is my firm belief. So the best part in our DPRs is that at pre-construction stage, it is an unwritten thing for us to go ahead with detailed investigations, pre-construction stage investigation, and optimize the project. Punasauchu 1 and 2 are examples for that. I don't have time here, and you'll not be interested in knowing the technical details. What I would like to tell you here, in Punasauchu 1, we did the changes in just about 4 months' time at the pre-construction stage, and investigation carried out by the same agency, assessment done by the same agencies, as I said, WAPCOS, Central Water Commission, Central East Authority, and Geological Survey of India. Top four in the country, in my country, they got associated, and we could optimize finally the project from its 1,095 megawatts capacity to 1,200 megawatts capacity. We initiated a change for a dam which is unique in Himalayas, unique in the world today. A concrete gravity dam which goes 80 meters below the riverbed level. Riverbed, if you see anywhere, when water is low, you'll find huge big boulders, pebbles, sand, all that stuff up to 80 meters of depth at that location, which is to be completely removed. Imagine for a dam which is only 50 meters high, utility above the riverbed is only 50. 80, you have to go below the riverbed. excavate the whole damn thing and replace it by concrete. This looked very, very difficult when we started. Therefore, we thought that we should scan the river and come up with a place which could be having lesser depth. We call it overburden depth in the riverbed. Friends, we had a reason. Punasangchu 2 was under investigation that time. And Punasangchu 1 dam to Punasangchu 2 dam was just a distance of 12 kilometers. 12 kilometers downstream of that place in the river, the depth of foundation was coming to only 30 to 35 meters below the riverbed. All these boulders, sand, pebbles were only 35 meters, compared to 80 at Punasangchu 1 dam site. Going downstream from that site along the river for almost 4 kilometers. The river had been scanned first by Norwegians, second time by Japanese, third time by Indian experts. So it was ruled out to go downstream. So what we thought that we come upstream, and if we be lucky, perhaps the depth of foundations would be less. We came, we tried our best. The optimum place above which we could not go is the location where we are doing it today. And if you see, we started the investigation that it would come to 35 to 40 meters. It came to full 80 meters here itself. But shifting, we have shifted by 1.5 kilometers, has given us an advantage of 25 meters of fall available in the river. Hydropower is quantity of water and the fall available, which we harness. And we got an advantage of about 25 meters of height against 275 of original. And the status remained the same, whether we do dam here or we do here. Same 80 meters to go down. And this was established well before we took up even the tendering process of that work, tendering process of that dam. General impression carried out here in some circles is that we started with some 30, 35 meters depth. A contract was awarded for that. And ultimately, when we came to construction, it comes out to be 80. No, friends, I want to keep the record straight here. Before even tendering process, the depth of 80 was confirmed. It was approved by the competent authority. Then alone we started the bidding process, and ultimately in March 2009, we awarded the contracts. This incidentally gave us an advantage of 105 megawatts of power with addition of only 1.4 kilometers of a tunnel. Entire project on the left bank, where the geology is supposed to be better than the right, 100% of uncertainty is covered. All the tunneling work is completed, including the powerhouse, which is an underground station. Except in the dam, where, as you see the river flowing, left bank, where it will abut, the dam will abut with the mountain, is absolutely stable. Right bank, which in appearance and investigation appeared to be better than the left, came out to really disgust us. And last July, we had a slide. Entire hill mass, it just shifted 5 meters down, 5 meters horizontally. More than 1.5 meter, 1.5 times the floor height. Shocking. We had immediate assessment works, investigated once again, come out with the measures to stabilize it, and that stabilization is on today. We have already resumed working, but the setback to the project is something like from November 16, it goes to May 18 earliest, Otherwise, it could be about November 18, immediately after monsoon. Friends, we go to Panasamchur 2. We are following a 7-year schedule, very, very tight schedule, including starting from a scratch, recruitments, having things in place, doing infrastructure to reach the project components. It was 990 megawatts with a power station in the open. Friends, when we came for optimization, it was 2010 June. We made everybody believe, come there and assess it. 10 experts from Bhutan, 10 experts from India, covering people from the disciplines of hydropower engineering, environment, and engineering geology. 10 plus 10, 20 of them. They came in August 2010 to the project site, and we told them the negativities of that open powerhouse, open to sky, compared to an underground structure. And we proposed areas where a powerhouse complex could be done underground. As I told you, the same group which had investigated and provided a DPR came, assessed on the recommendations of these 20, 10 here, 10 there, we took up detailed investigation. In detailed investigation, we got the approval to go ahead, invest in the investigations in September 10. By December 10, within about 5 months, we investigated it to a level which was much better than the DPR. And reason, do you know why? Not that me and Amit Gupta were there, no. Reason was that we were provided with better resources, especially the finances. And the same people, same experts from Delhi came, assessed, and in December 2010, we had the clearance for an underground station. And you'll be happy to know, all of you, that the entire, now the situation has changed. Panasamchur 1, that reached first 12 kilometers, left bank was superior, geologically. Now we are on the right bank, which is superior. And we'll be happy to know that today, in spite of the Himalayan geology, is not simple. Every 10 meters it changes. Best of the engineering geologists with real vision fail to understand the Himalayan geology. Today you'll be happy to know that we are almost 100% covered in the underground construction. And the station capacity has increased marginally by 30 megawatts. Between the two projects, we have added 135 megawatts, which is more than Kurichu in the east, 60 megawatts, and two Basachus, 64, 124 megawatts. This is just an optimization, which was a necessity. Gentlemen, I thank you very much.